Good afternoon, sir. What's your name?
My name is Val Bonilla.
Yes, we're here reflecting on the life and the contributions of Herman. Can you tell me something about your relationship?
Well, yes, I met Herman quite a while ago. I was actually the chief PA at the Beth Israel Methadone program, and he and I had a number of conversations, actually, and I met him way back many, many years ago. In fact, I believe I was at the ATOT conference when he received the Marie Nicewander Award, which I believe back in those days was the Doe Nicewander Award. And we've had a number of conversations. He and I met eye to eye in many, many issues.
Tell me some of the contributions from your perspective that he made to the field, and because he wore many hats from probation to the science of it.
Oh, absolutely. One of the things I always noticed about Herman was he was real emphatic about the patient's perspective of what it was all about. You know, stigma was not a new word for him. He knew that from way back when there was all sorts of stigma, not just about treatment, but about addiction itself. And he was one of those individuals that always spoke about how the importance of the patient as a victim of the disease rather than a perpetrator, which unfortunately a lot of people looked at it. And so he was always there advocating.
Well, Val, we seem to make a partition now with the opioid crisis of today and the pioneering work of Herman and other people when it comes to ethnicity. Can you please share with us what you think the scope of the American problem is, or the New York problem, in terms of stigma and in terms of addiction? I know that's a broad question, but you're really quite a specialist.
Well, you know, I mean, I feel exactly the same way Herman did all of those years. I mean, for me, you know, the patients have no fault for their disease. You know, they are the victims of the disease, and many of them became addicted as a result of possible predisposition. You know, I mean, everybody, for the most part, uses one drug or another, but then there are others. There are those that are very much vulnerable to the effects of certain drugs, and you know, many of these patients who became opioid addicts are some of those people. Unfortunately, sometimes there's so much stigma that even the patients themselves stigmatize themselves. You know, they have low self-esteem. You know, for them, you know, treatment is just another drug. You know, particularly medication-assisted treatment, just one drug for the other. So most of them, you know, try so hard to satisfy everyone else's idea about, you know, drug addiction and that you shouldn't use. And so they were always looking for abstinence, not realizing that treatment, you know, for them was probably a more viable alternative. And when they finally realized that it was, they were very grateful to be on medication.
What could be expectations in the life of someone sustaining or dealing with resilience through MA2?
Well, here again, like I said, you know, many of them take many years before they even try medication-assisted treatment, and for the most part, when they finally take the medication and take it appropriately based on the treatment from those who are, you know, educated in its use, you know, these patients become extremely productive individuals, which was their intention, you know, all along, to feel and function better. And quite frankly, the patients that I've known, because I was in the field for 41 years, in fact, I'm still
there. Tell me about your background.
Well, you know, I was the very first PA, or one of the very first PAs hired at the Beth Israel Methadone program back in 1976. I eventually became the chief PA for the program. I was chief PA.
What is a PA?
PA physician assistant.
Okay.
You know, most of what we did was probably indistinguishable from the physician in terms of the patient's point of view. You know, we took care of the patients. You know, we did the physicals, we examined the patients, we spoke to them about, you know, substance abuse and treatment, you know, and basically just cared for them.
What was the sort of the ethnic background or breakdown during that particular time in the 70s? And let's jump into 2019 and give us a scope of what we're talking about.
Well, quite frankly, for me, and it's funny that you asked that question, because I've said to many, when I started working in the methadone program way back in the mid-70s, you know, we had a breakdown of patients that was not really much different than it is now, depending on which clinic you were working in. If you were working in one of the Harlem clinics, you know, more of the patients, you know, were African-American minorities or Hispanics. If you were working down in the Lower East Side, you probably had a mix of half and half of Caucasian patients, and then the other half a mixture of African-American and Hispanics. And the treatment that I, and the program that I was in, you know, was pretty much, you know, mixed. So there were very many, you know, Caucasian patients that I had, and in fact, most of my patients that had been there the longest were Caucasian patients, you know, versus, you know, blacks and Hispanics, although eventually, you know, the numbers change over time.
Are we talking about cocktails now in terms of fentanyl mixtures or the kind of combinations of drugs that are on the street now?
You know, I don't know that that's actually new. I mean, many, many, many years ago, when fentanyl, you know, hit the market real hard, you know, there were patients out there in the street that were purposely buying heroin, which was laced with fentanyl, when they heard that it was some really, really good stuff. And it wasn't because they were trying to overdose from it, but because their tolerance probably for heroin was so high, and at the time, the quality may not have been as good, that they were looking for a medication that was able to sustain what probably was closer to their tolerance levels, which, quite frankly, was one of the reasons why it was a good thing that they came onto the methadone program, because we were able to match, you know, whatever those tolerance levels were and get the patients to feel and function normally over time.
How do you define the opioid painkiller epidemic right now, and then what's going on in the streets and other zip codes, like street drugs in the urban center in Harlem and other zip codes, and, you know, Durham and North Carolina, and, you know, I mean, how do you characterize Wayne today? And because it just seems like when you talk to people and you say opioids and painkillers, you're saying white privileged people in certain zip codes, and that doesn't involve black people with traditional heroin habits and mixed media of cocktails in terms of drugs. I mean,
well, you know, that's sort of an easy and yet an extremely difficult question to answer when it comes to looking at pain management,
yeah,
and looking at opioid treatment is two totally separate things. You know, there's no question that there are many patients who didn't realize that they might have been susceptible to the ravages of addiction until they had some sort of an incident which caused them to have to be prescribed pain medication.
You're saying the opioids is a quite quick curve into addiction? What's that kind of profile like?
No, what I'm saying is that the number of people that actually become addicted, you know, or you can be classified as being addicted to pain management medications is probably not that much different than the number of patients that become addicted to any other substances, you know, whether it be cocaine or nicotine and tobacco or even alcohol for that matter. The majority of individuals are able to take these different substances and take them recreationally, which is what generally happens. And then you have another subset of individuals that once they start doing this, it triggers something.
Is there a predisposition in terms of DNA? You think?
Well, when you're talking about predisposition, you know, within the system, absolutely. You know, there's a predisposition with any disease. In fact, one of the things that classifies a disease is predisposition. You know, the other thing is an unknown etiology, meaning you don't know why this individual happened to have the disease versus their own brother and sister who came through, you know, the same genetics and somehow, you know, was not affected, you know, by the disease. It's not really that much different from any other drug. You know, on the other hand, because because the pain management medications, the opioids, resemble the same medications that these individuals abuse in the street, there's a real potential that once you come in contact with them, that you certainly could wind up beginning to use from them. The unfortunate part of that is that